Okay, I think we'll get started. Good morning, everyone. I'm Jennifer Curtis, Dean of the College of Engineering, and thank you for joining us for the College Distinguished Lecture. Our College Distinguished Lecture series provides us an opportunity to interact with internationally renowned speakers and to learn from them in areas of research, technical innovation, and other engineering topics. And I'm very honored today to introduce our college distinguished lecturer, Dr. Vincent Poor, the Michael Henry Strater University Professor of Electrical Engineering at Princeton University, and the former Dean of Princeton School of Engineering and Applied Science. In addition to his more than 25 years at Princeton University, Dr. Poor has held visiting appointments at a number of other universities, including Stanford and Cambridge, and he's currently the Miller Visiting Professor, Research Professor at UC Berkeley. His research interests are primarily in the areas of information theory and signal processing with applications to wireless networks, smart grids, and related fields. Among his publications in these areas is the book, Smart Grid Communications and Networking. He is a member of both the National Academy of Engineering and the National Academy of Sciences, and he's also a foreign member of the Royal Society. He's the former president of the IEEE Information Theory Society and the former editor-in-chief of the IEEE Transactions on Information Theory. He also currently serves on the board of a number of nonprofit organizations, including the Corporation for National Research Initiatives, the IEEE Foundation, the National Academy of Engineering, and Swarthmore College. And some of his other recent recognitions include his 2014 URSI Booker Gold Medal, the 2016 John Fritz Medal, and the 2017 IEEE Alexander Graham Bell Medal. And he's received honorary doctorates and professorships from a number of universities. So we are so honored that you're here with us today to be our distinguished speaker. And I ask that you all please join me in welcoming Dr. Poor for his lecture, Smart Grid, Energy Meets Information. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dean Curtis, for that very kind introduction. Really appreciate it. And thank you for inviting me to be here today. I really am honored to be part of this series. I understand that my successor, Emily Carter, will be here next year. So this is, you're on a Princeton Dean run here. So I'm sure she'll do a much better job than I will, actually. She's an extremely good speaker. So come for that one for sure. I'm delighted to be here. And smart grid is a term that's applied to an emerging generation of electricity grids in which there's a cyber layer of sensors, controls, communication networks superimposed on the physical or electromechanical layer of the traditional electricity grid, which consists of generators, loads, relays, and lines connecting them. Okay. So the introduction of this cyber layer, so it creates a so-called cyber physical system, and it invites the application of ideas and techniques from the information sciences in energy systems. So my background, as Dean Curtis mentioned, is more in the information sciences side of electrical engineering. I'm not really a full disclosure, I'm not a power systems engineer. Although I studied it many years ago as an undergraduate, I'm really coming to this field from a different angle, which is from wireless networking and other kinds of networking, cyber networking types of structures, where ideas from the information sciences are the primary application. So just also point out something interesting about smart grid. You see my title, Energy Meets Information. Electrical engineering, those of you who are electrical engineers probably know this, comes from two different disciplines. One is power systems, and the other is communication. So traditionally, from the 19th century, this was the birth of electrical engineering. And these were typically distinct areas until, the 1950s or 60s, when departments started coalescing with these two things together. Today, of course, electrical engineering is much more diverse, has semiconductors and other things like this. But in this field, smart grid, sort of these two traditional areas of electrical engineering have sort of been merged into one area. So it's another thing I like about it. So in any case, I'm going to try to talk for maybe 40 minutes and then give you time to ask questions at the end if you like. And I'll start out by saying a little bit more about what smart grid is and why it's important. And then I'm going to go through and talk about several areas of information sciences that can be applied in smart grid. And these are all going to be examples from my own research, but I don't want to give the impression that we're the only ones working on this because it's a very big field with many other people. I'll also talk a little bit in each case about one particular area in more depth, but I'm not going to give any references or anything like that. Everything I'm going to talk about, there are papers and so forth associated with it, and I'll be happy to share those with anybody who wants more depth. And there's my email address there, which is very easy to remember, poor@princeton.edu. Okay. All righty, so let's get started. First of all, what is smart grid? Well, some people call it the Internet of Energy, okay? And that's because, as I said, it's kind of a cyber system connected to a physical system, just like the Internet is a cyber system connected to the physical system of communications and the ether and so forth. So the traditional grid, and this is really an oversimplification because the traditional grid has been evolving over 100 years into something more sophisticated, but this is really sort of one way to think about smart grid. The traditional grid, as I said earlier, is an electromechanical system. The generation is centralized, so you have power plants, nuclear plants, for example. There are very few sensors. There are sensors, the so-called SCADA system in the traditional grid, but the sensors are sparse. Most of the monitoring and restoration is manual. That is, there are people sitting in a control center doing that. There are failures and blackouts. I don't know if you have those in California, but in the East, it happens all the time, every time there's a storm. Yeah, okay, so you know what I'm talking about. And the customers don't really have much to say about what's happening. It's really a very centralized system. Smart grid, on the other hand, as I said before, is a cyber-physical system. In addition to this electromechanical system, there's a cyber system on top. The generation is increasingly distributed, so you have not only small, say, gas-fired power plants that can be turned on and off more quickly, but you also have renewable sources, solar and wind, for example, that are distributed out into the grid. There are many more sensors, so there's sort of a big data aspect to the grid. The data collected by the grid is sort of in the petabyte range, huge worldwide. The intention is that it becomes self-monitoring and self-healing so that that it can quickly respond to problems on its own and heal from those without doing extensive damage. Adaptive and reliable because the load and generation are both changing in time. And the customers have more to say. You can make more decisions about things that are happening in your local power area, distribution area. So why should we have a smart grid? Well, first of all, just to enhance the efficiency of existing generation. So it's estimated that the carbon footprint of the United States is almost 40% of the carbon footprint of the United States is accounted for by electricity generation. I think it's 38%. So it's a huge amount of our carbon footprint, and there's a lot of inefficiency because of the system is geared for peak load, which happens in the daytime, and there's not a lot of need for that load at night. So there are already some inefficiencies built in that could be, without any other changes, if you could shift the peak, move the peak down and shift load into the night, for example, you can get much more efficient generation. Also, facilitate the deployment of renewables, which is another factor contributing to lowering the carbon footprint of power generation. Renewables are variable sources. They're harder to incorporate into the grid and so forth, but that's another thing that the smart grid is about. Enabling resilience. Of course, we just talked about outages and so forth. So another idea here is to make it easier for the power companies to restore power more quickly. Automation of maintenance, another issue. Improving security of the grid. So when you have introduce a cyber system, of course, you introduce the danger of cyber attacks. So there's two sides of this. Part of it is you can maybe make the grid less secure, but by having the cyber resources there, you can also try to improve grid security. I'm going to talk about that in more detail in a minute. Smoothing transition to storage, and of which electrical vehicles is part of that. So allowing storage to be integrated more fully into the grid. Allowing customers to have more choices, so what's called demand-side management, I'll talk about a bit in a minute, which will enable new products, services, and markets to emerge in the electricity market. But the bottom line is, the idea with grid, with the smart grid, is to have greater efficiency, security, and reliability in electricity generation and use. So that's the bottom line. So, as I said at the beginning, the introduction of the cyber layer invites the application of methodologies from information sciences in energy systems. Okay, so it sort of merges the energy systems with information systems that make up most of electrical engineering. And some of those fields are from information sciences that are useful here and have been applied in smart grid are shown here. So optimization, obviously, game theory, which is sort of like distributed optimization, and control, communications, networking, and information theory. These are my main area of interest. And then statistical inference, machine learning, and signal processing, because we're dealing with big data problems. Okay. And what I'm going to do for the rest of my talk is talk about these three highlighted areas, game theory, information theory, and statistical inference, and how they can be applied in energy systems. Okay, so that's really the heart of my talk. All right, so let's start out with talking about game theory. Okay, so game theory, of course, was born in economics, right? And it's a way of looking at economic systems and trying to understand how they behave, how players in economic systems or people in economic systems behave. And the whole idea is to create more efficient economic systems, right? And the same kind of ideas apply in the smart grid. And to see that, why that might be so, we can think about some of these salient properties of the grid or the key properties of the grid. First of all, it's heterogeneous. Okay, there are many grid elements, there are loads, there are generators, there are all kinds of different things, storage elements and so forth, each of which has its own objective. So it's not like everyone is pulling together with one objective in mind. Also, the interactions are large scale, both geographically, because we have, you know, the power grid is kind of has a continental scale, right? And in terms of in network terms, because the number of participants is extremely large, hundreds of millions, right? So it's very big. And then it's changing in a random way. There's stochastic dynamics. So the demand obviously changes randomly over time. And now with renewables, the supply is also changing in a stochastic way. So these are similar to the things you might say about an economic system, right? So for the same reason that game theory is useful in economics, it's also useful in studying the behavior of systems like this. So game theory is a useful framework here, and there are three forms of game theory, which are each of which has its own use in studying elements of smart grid. Okay, competitive games or non-cooperative games, which are sort of the classic kind of games you think about. Cooperative games and prospect theory. And I'm going to say a little bit about each of these now. So an example where competitive games are useful in studying the grid is in energy trading. So when you have multiple players who are controlling energy sources and storage and so forth, all of a sudden you have a situation where you can start having energy trading markets going on. So this is really a classical economics problem. It's not even that far from economics. And this is an area where you can try to understand these markets using competitive games. The people who control energy or need energy are competing for it in a marketplace. If you have peers who are competing, you can think about Nash games, which are sort of zero-sum person-to-person games, or if you have a leader, like a utility company, which is setting prices, you can think about a Stackelberg game, which is a leader-follower game type of game. So the utility company is the leader, and then the other participants in the grid are followers. Okay, so that's one area where game theory can be applied almost just verbatim from economics in smart grid. Another area of interest is where game theory can be used is a so-called microgrid integration. Okay, so the grid, there are two main parts of the grid. There's a transmission grid, or the main grid, which consists of the high voltage lines that you see marching across the landscape, these tall towers. And then there's the distribution grid where we live, the lower voltage parts, right? So we're, you know, the lights and everything here and the screen and so forth are on the distribution grid. So traditionally, elements in the distribution grid would trade back and forth with the main grid. So you buy energy, and even if you had generation, you would sell it back in the main grid. But you can think about sort of so-called microgrids down in the distribution network where you have storage devices, generators like solar and wind and loads all down in the distribution grid, and they can form microgrids down there, and then they can interact with one another rather than interacting with the main grid all the time. They can interact with one another. So that kind of integration and interaction can be modeled using another type of games called coalition games, which I'm going to talk more specifically about this in a second. But the idea is that here is more cooperative type of situation, and so microgrid elements can form coalitions. Perhaps generators with loads can share, can trade back and forth down in the microgrid. So that's another type of game theory that can be useful here. And then finally, I'll mention demand-side management, which is basically management of the grid that involves decisions by consumers. So this is a big peak load shifting is a big part of that is demand-side management, where you try to get the consumers to push their loads into the night, for example, turn the washing machine on at night rather than in the daytime and things like that, or shift your air conditioning off to other times and so forth. So because you have humans here making decisions, this is an area where behavioral economics can come into play. And the mathematics of behavioral economics is prospect theory. Okay, so it's another type of game theory modified for people's subjectivity in making decisions. And this is an area where this is a fairly new area of application of game theory in smart grid, is the use of prospect theory and trying to understand demand-side management. And I should say that power companies, or at least PSE&G, which is the power company in New Jersey and Long Island, is very well aware of this issue because they've tried developing programs based on, you know, more expected utility type of theory of how consumers might behave, and they don't behave that way. So it's been demonstrated in practice that human subjectivity is an issue in demand-side management, and so this is an area where something like prospect theory, which has been successful in understanding economics with subjectivity, is useful also here as well. So I'm just going to dig in a little bit deeper in this microgrid integration example. I don't know if I have a pointer or not. Maybe this one? I don't seem to have a pointer. Oh, nope. I think I just went off the, let me get back to full screen here if I can. Can you put that back to full screen? I don't seem to have, the pointer's in the middle. Oh, there we go. Okay, got it. Thank you. Okay, thanks. Sorry about that. So I'm gonna dig in a little more deeply here just briefly, just to give you a sense of what this might mean. So, as I mentioned, there's two things. There's the sort of macro grid or transmission grid, and then there's the distribution grid, where there are all these so-called microgrid elements, you know, wind farms, solar arrays, loads, storage devices, and so forth. And, of course, in sort of a classical grid, they would all whatever energy exchange they do would be exchanged mostly with the main grid, if not you consumed locally. So one of the things you might think about doing is to allow these elements to interact with one another down here in the distribution grid rather than interacting with the main grid. And one, there are many objectives. One is you could think of just sort of some kind of financial objective, but another objective might be to reduce power losses because these are co-located and so they don't need to distribute power over as long a line. So you could think about a public good as being just reducing power losses by interacting down in the distribution grid. So one of the ways to model that kind of activity would be, or that kind of behavior would be using a so-called coalition game that models the process of the elements forming cooperatives to trade energy down in the distribution grid. Okay, and I'm not going to talk about it, but I'll just note you can also invoke prospect theory down here, thinking that there are humans making decisions down in this thing, but I'm not going to talk about that further today. But just, again, this is very brief, but this just is a sort of a typical kind of result you can see. This is a situation where you have a fixed, I think it's 10 kilometers by 10 kilometer distribution area, and what's shown here is the average cost, which is power loss per microgrid element, versus the number of microgrid elements. So as this number goes up, the microgrid elements become denser, so closer together. And you can see that what's shown here in blue is the sort of the power losses if you trade only with the main grid. Okay, if these elements, so it's more or less constant. And this shows what happens if you allow coalitions to form, and coalitions do form. In fact, I think I showed here, there are, one of the simulation run, these are the coalitions that you get. And basically, it's not very surprising, but it shows that if you do implement a system where you allow these kind of, this kind of trading to go on, that it can result in considerable savings, at least in this kind of situation. Okay, so now, so that I can stay on time, I'm not going to talk more about game theory now, but I want to shift gears and talk a little bit about the application of information theory in the grid. And here I'm going to talk mainly about security. So information theory is very useful in thinking about information security in various ways. And I'm going to talk particularly about privacy, so privacy aspects of the grid. So here's a motivation for that. So first of all, we have the cyber layer, and it generates considerable data, okay? And there are a lot of ways it generates data. There are all kinds of sensors there, power flow sensors. There are also so-called phasor measurement units, which are a way of rapidly sampling the state of the grid. And there are smart meters, okay? I'll talk more about smart meters in a minute. And these things are generating lots of data. As I mentioned, they're sort of data profiles are certainly terabytes, hundreds of terabytes for a given utility. They could be petabytes over, say, a year's worth of data could be a petabyte. So there's a lot of data out there. And of course, the reason why this data is being generated is because it's useful, right? Nobody's going to go to this trouble if the data is not useful. And the utility of the data depends on accessibility. So if you don't publish the data in some way, it's not useful at all. On the other hand, I'll talk about some examples in a minute, but there are privacy issues with this data. It's not, there are private things contained in that data that you may not want to share with everyone. So accessibility endangers privacy. But here there's a posing criteria. So you can make the data as useful as it can be by publishing everything, right? But then you've destroyed whatever privacy there was. And you can also make the data as private as you want by not publishing anything, right? Just lock the data away in a vault, and it's completely private. That's not good either. So there's a natural trade-off in any data source, not just here, between the utility of the data and privacy of the data, okay? So one question we can ask, and we have asked, is what is the fundamental trade-off between utility and privacy in data sources? And that's a trade-off that we can characterize using information theory. And one way to do that is to trade off some measure of information leakage. Here we call it, this particular one is quantity called equivocation that I'm showing here, but there are any measure of information leakage, so information theory gives rise to a lot of such possibilities, versus some measure of usefulness of the data. So here I've shown usefulness as lack of distortion in the data, but you can choose your favorite criteria for information leakage and utility, and then you can create, using information theoretic tools, the so-called utility privacy or privacy utility trade-off region, and that will have an outer boundary, which is like an efficient frontier for this trade-off, meaning it shows you the optimal trade-off between utility and privacy. So it doesn't tell you what to do, it just tells you what you can do. So if you want to get a given level of utility, it tells you how much privacy you have to give up, or vice versa. You want to put an upper bound on how much private information you reveal, then it's going to tell you, well, this is the maximum amount of utility you can get out of your system. So this could be applicable to other, like social networking or other kinds of areas where you trade privacy for utility, so banking online, all those kinds of things are things where you have this kind of trade-off. But it particularly comes up in the smart grid. So here are a couple of examples. One is smart meter privacy. Now, smart meter, I think you have those in Northern California. PG&E put them in, controversially, I heard. But a smart meter is a meter, basically, that unlike old-timey meters where a person would come out and write down once a month your usage, a smart meter reports back your usage in almost real time. So that's very useful for load balancing, pricing, and so forth like that in order to help the system be more efficient, maybe shifting load into the night and things like that by pricing. But on the other hand, it also can, so that's the utility of a smart meter. On the other hand, it can be very revealing of private things. So this is a cartoon of a smart meter trace, but the real ones look a lot like this. And basically, the things that you do in your house electrically, turn on the coffee pot, the microwave, television, each of those things has a recognizable signature in the smart meter trace. So that means someone looking at smart meter data can tell what's happening in your house, at least in terms of what you're turning on, what you're turning off, and so forth. Particularly, they can tell whether you're home or not, things like that, okay? They can tell a lot about your lifestyle and so forth. So there's clearly a privacy utility trade-off here, and this is something we can study using this formalism. And this one I'm going to talk about a bit more in just a second, so I won't talk about it anymore now. Another interesting privacy utility trade-off is the problem of competitive privacy, which also comes up in other fields, but here you can think about it in the following context. So the grid operation consists of many different entities. There are companies, there are so-called regional transmission organizations that manage the grid and their regions, and they have the goal of accurately estimating the state of the grid so that they can make decisions about what resources to apply and so forth. To do that, it's useful for them to exchange information because the grid, of course, they're interconnected through the grid. It's not walled off from region to region. So there's a utility in exchanging information among multiple agents that are operating the grid. Okay. But of course, they're also competing. They're private companies competing for business and so forth. So there's also a privacy issue about trading information, exchanging information to estimate the state of the grid. So here you have a privacy utility trade-off for each of these entities, but they're also competing with one another. So there's a so-called competitive privacy. And that gives rise to a lot of other interesting problems. And in fact, you can introduce game theory here as well, to try to understand how these players will behave in this kind of a market. So that's another totally different problem from the smart meter privacy problem, where information theory has a useful role. Let me talk a little bit more depth about smart meter privacy, just to give you a little bit of a sense of how this goes. So remember I said that smart meter data is useful because it can be used for pricing and load balancing and so forth. But also, it can leak information about what's going on in the home. So that's the source of the privacy utility trade-off. Now, there are a couple of approaches that we've looked at for this problem. One is to do source coding at the meter or signal processing at the meter to try to do something to suppress the private information coming out without hurting too much the utility of the grid. And it turns out there's a very nice classical solution to this problem, which is called reverse water filling. And I'll just say a little bit about what this is. You're basically doing source coding at the meter or data compression at the meter, so a signal processing at the meter to try to suppress certain things about the that you don't want to reveal while not being too damaging to the usefulness of the meter data. And so reverse water filling, which is a classical source coding technique from information theory, basically works like this. So you look at the spectrum or the power spectral density of the meter trace, and you set a water level called phi here, and then you suppress those elements of the meter trace those frequency elements of the meter trace whose power is below the water level. And then everything else you let go through undistorted. So the idea here is that these, the transient things, the things that are most informative, or the intermittent things, are really the things that have low power, even though instantaneously they have high power. Over a long time, it's your refrigerator, your air conditioner, and so forth, are the things that have most of the power. So in doing this, you're suppressing those things which are most informative, but you're letting through information about those things which are the most important to the grid operator. And this turns out to be on the boundary of the utility privacy trade-off region here, and you can trace that boundary out by moving the water level up and down. So lower water level means greater utility, lower privacy. Higher water level is the opposite. So another way to effect a trade-off here is forget about source coding at the meter and try to control your usage in a way that affects a utility privacy trade-off, okay? And here we can use a control theoretic approach, okay? So here's the load. Slightly different picture. This is the load. Here's the meter, smart meter. There's a utility provider. And now suppose we have energy harvesting on premises. So we have a solar array on the roof, say, and we have a storage. So we have a Tesla in the garage. Okay. And then we can have an energy management unit that takes in the information about what energy is being harvested, what the load is at any given time, and decides how much to, and what the state of the battery is, and decides how much energy to take out of the battery to supply the load, and how much energy to pull off the grid to supply the load. Okay, and so all this together can work together in a way that sort of trades off information leakage from the load back to the meter. Okay, and the trade-off here is really about information leakage versus wasted energy, because when doing this control, you're inevitably going to waste energy, okay? So we can look at that trade-off. That's another utility privacy trade-off. Turns out this problem is too hard to solve analytically, but we can solve it numerically for under certain assumptions, and we can get the utility privacy region shown here. This is just for a particular example, but it just shows that each one of these is a numerical run. And this shows the efficient frontier here. This is information leakage rate. We'd like it to be small. This is average wasted power. We'd like it to be small. So ideal is down here at the origin. And you can see here's the efficient frontier. This frontier, I don't have any curves to show this, but this frontier can be moved closer and closer and closer to the origin by getting a bigger and bigger and bigger battery. Okay. Okay, so let me turn now to the last topic, which is inferential methods for greater reliability. And here, so I remember we're talking about efficiency, security, and reliability. And here we're talking about basically situational awareness of the grid so that we can operate it in a very effective way, okay, in a reliable way, okay. Inference, of course, means things like detection, estimation, and so forth. So what are the motivation here? Well, first of all, as I mentioned twice earlier, the smart grid involves a big data problem. So, okay, it's a lot of data being generated in a distributed manner. Okay, So you have big data, and there are communication bottlenecks. You can't necessarily transmit all this data at will, okay, because it's huge amounts of data. Also, the networks are very large, hundreds of millions of nodes. So any inferential problems involving these networks tend to be very complex. So you have communications challenges and computational challenges in dealing with the grid. And what are we trying to do with this data? Well, we want situational awareness. So some of the issues we'd like to deal with are state estimation under normal operation. So I mentioned earlier these regional transmission organizations. They're trying to estimate the state of the grid so they know what's happening in the grid, right, so they can make decisions. Well, just under normal operations, you want to estimate the state of the grid. Also, when failures start, you'd like to be able to quickly track cascading failures so that you can island them, just like you island a forest fire, right? You want to cut them off so that you don't take down the whole East Coast because of cascading failures. These failures are usually caused by natural disasters, hurricanes and so forth. It's important infrastructure, and it's also a target of terrorist attack, right? Or a potential target of terrorist attack, and you'd like to be able to detect attacks on the grid. So these are some of the inferential problems that come up in smart grid, trying to make the grid more reliable. So let me just give a couple of examples, and I'll dig into one of them again. So the first problem I'll talk about is distributed inference, and I'm going to talk about this one in more depth, so I'll just go briefly here. But essentially, because the data is distributed, and because the problem is large, okay, computationally, you'd like to distribute the computational and so forth out into the grid. And that's a classical problem in statistical inference. It goes back at least to the 40 years ago, maybe longer, distributed inference. But there's an interesting twist here, and that is that the grid has two topologies. There are two networks. There's a physical network, which is the thing you're trying to make inferences about. And then there's the cyber network, which is the thing that where data flows and where the computations are done and so forth. So you have one topology where you're doing your computations or you're making inferences, but the thing you're making inferences about has a totally different topology. So that makes the problem interesting, and I'll talk about that in more depth in a minute. Another problem of interest is real-time topology identification, okay? And the idea is that you'd like to, when you start having cascading failures, you'd like to quickly see what's happening to the topology of the grid so that you can island off the failure and prevent it from going further. But this is a very, very computationally difficult problem because it's a combinatorial problem in the number of nodes. Number of nodes is very large. So it invites application of lower complexity methods such as machine learning techniques to do topology identification in real time, meaning as it's happening, to see what's happening in the topology. And there's some interesting results there, fairly recent results there. And then finally, I'll mention attack detection. Again, this we're thinking here about attacks like terrorist attacks on the grid. There are two types of attacks that are of concern. Data attacks, which are attacks that attempt to change the estimates of the state of the grid without actually changing the state itself. So the operator sees that something's happening when nothing's really happening. And so that's a problem because then the operator responds in some way that might be inappropriate. Okay. Then another type of attack is a physical attack, which might also be implemented using a cyber attack on a power plant or something, where you actually, the dual of a data attack, you actually want to change the state of the grid in some unfavorable way without changing the state estimate. So that something's happening in the grid that's bad and the operators don't know it, okay? So these are two types of attacks that you're concerned about. They can be modeled in very interesting ways. There's a lot of interesting recent work in this area too. So this is another area where inference has a big role to play there as well. So let me talk briefly about this problem. and then I'll wrap up, and I think we'll be just about right on time. Okay. So let's talk a little bit about distributed state estimation here. So when we talk about state estimation in the grid, we're usually trying to estimate the phases at the interconnection points of the grid, which are called buses. Okay. And we like to do that, as I said, by using distributed processing, just for multiple reasons, because the data is distributed. It's hard to get it all in one place because of communication bottlenecks, and also because it's just a very large computational problem. So the desired properties here are: we'd like to have no central control, no central coordinator for estimation. We'd like to use at each. We can think about the grid as being divided up into control areas, and each control area uses only local information, that information generated locally. So we don't have to ship information all over the grid. The control areas themselves may not necessarily be able to independently estimate the state of the grid. Okay, they may be too isolated or not have enough measurement, rich enough measurements to do that. We'd like it to be flexible in communication topology. That's not a big issue, but we'd also like, if possible, for each of these control areas to be able to get global situational awareness. That is, we'd like to be able to somehow find distributed algorithms that allow control areas using a distributed algorithm to get some kind of centralized, situational awareness about the entire grid. It's in a way, this would be equivalent to what a centralized estimator could get if all the data could be put in one place. Okay, well, it seems like a lot to ask, but actually it's not too much to ask because there is a family of algorithms that can achieve these goals. So I don't have any equations here, but this is, I guess, sort of an equation, but no mathematical formulas. But we can look at a family of estimators called consensus plus innovation estimators that basically do iterative estimation at each control area, and they iterate by taking a current estimate or a previous estimate and creating a new estimate by using two correction terms. One is what I would say is a classical innovation correction or residual error correction, which is just trying to make the data fit as closely as possible to the estimate. And the other is what's called a consensus correction, which is attempting to create consensus among neighboring control areas. So you can exchange information with your neighbors, and you'd like to, at some point, all achieve the same view of the situational awareness, right? So this type of correction is based on the cyber topology, and this type of correction is based on the physical topology. So you've introduced both topologies here in this kind of estimate. Well, it turns out that for properly chosen parameters, obviously it's an iterative algorithm, there's some parameters in there. If you have two properties, global observability of the grid, which is a property of the physical system, mathematical property of the physical system, which says that if you saw all the measurements, you could make an accurate estimate. And connectivity of the network, the cyber network, which is a means that not that every node is connected to every other node, but that every node can reach every other node through enough intermediate nodes. Okay, this is another mathematical property. It can be tested using the so-called graph Laplacian. So it's an easy test for that. If you have both of those properties, you can get convergence of these local estimates all to global least squares, which is the globally optimal estimator. So you can achieve the goals with this kind of algorithm. So you come up with this idea of distributed observability. So this is observability is a property of the whole grid. Distributed observability is a property of both the cyber and the physical network. So if you have global observability, which is a property of the physical network, and interagent network connectivity, which is a property of the cyber network, you get so-called distributed observability, which is this property. And just a simple example, this is an IEEE 118 bus test system. This is one of the systems that IEEE publishes for testing grid algorithms. This one in particular is a globally observable system. The control areas, which are shown here in cartoon, are none of them is globally observable. That is, no control area can estimate the entire state by itself. The pink ones are locally unobservable. That is, they can't even estimate their own state of their own, or their own local area by themselves. Okay, so this is a there's a lot of lack of observability here on the distributed front. But this system is globally observable, and there are a couple of communication networks shown here with these dashed lines. They're all connected in the sense that I said. So these algorithms should work here. And in fact, here's a, just an example to show. This is showing the convergence of certain phase angle estimates to global least squares over time as the algorithm iterates. So we know from the theory that it does, but this is just an example to show that. Okay, so almost out of time and almost out of slides, fortunately. So here's a summary of what I talked about today. So the smart grid is a cyber-physical approach to greater power system efficiency, security, and reliability. And the cyber-physical nature of this smart grid invites techniques from the information sciences into the optimization of, and understanding of energy systems. And here today, I talked about three things: game theory, information theory, and statistical inference. So with that, I'm done, and I'm happy to take questions. So thank you.
Okay, so now we have time for Q&A, and I ask that all the people who have questions, please go to the microphone right there to ask your questions so everyone can hear, and we are recording. So first question for Dr. Poor. Please, to the microphone.
Hello.
Yeah.
So in smart grid, smart meter, you told that it tracks each and every activity, but is that encrypted over a channel? Because otherwise a hacker can come to know what you are doing and...
Yeah, so that's a good point. So there are two issues there with smart grid. So the question, I think everybody heard that, the question is it encrypted? Well, there are two issues, and the encryption goes to another issue from the one I talked about here, right? So there's the issue of privacy, where you want to remain private from the utility company, right? And that's what I talked about here. So I didn't talk about anything about data confidentiality, which means that an outside attacker can, you also don't want the outside attacker, an outside eavesdropper to look at the data. That's a security problem. And to deal with that, you could deal with it using encryption. I don't know whether smart meters are encrypted or not. There may be somebody here in the audience who does. I suspect there's some light encryption there because otherwise it would be a natural information leakage problem, but I don't really know exactly how they're, there are a lot of different makers of smart meters. I don't know exactly how they handled that particular issue. But it's another separate issue from this one, but it's also an important one, of course. Yeah, good question.
So very interesting talk regarding the inference aspect. You discussed, Vince, regarding the detection of a cyber attacks to a smart grid. Are these attacks happening daily or very often? So in other words, when you want to identify attacks and sources, don't we need to have enough samples to know that the system has been under attack and identify certain features and phenomena that will help you in the future to make that determination? So has such a data been made available and allows people to experiment?
That's a great question. So let me say two things about it. First of all, there have been many attempts cyber attack on the grid, and not only just the grid, but on other parts of infrastructure, you know, dams and so forth. You read about them in the paper all the time. So there, the attacks are typically, in the grid, are typically on sort of isolated power stations and things like that where the security may not be so strong. There have been a lot of discovered attempts, okay? I don't know that there are any documented ones that have succeeded, okay? There have been physical attacks that weren't cyber initiated down in the South Bay. There was a guy with a gun shot up a substation, right? But that's a different thing. So the answer is yes. There have been many attempts. I don't think there have been any successful attempts. But the nature of this work is really not sort of like I see what you're getting at. You're saying, well, you have some statistical samples of attacks and non-attacks, and you put together a test. But this is a little different kind of work. So the work here is more based on looking at the grid topology and trying to decide where attacks could be injected and not observed. So it's not really about looking at that. It's more about where could they be observed. And then the countermeasures are, where do you put sensors so that that can't happen? And it's a little bit like another problem in communications, which is jamming. With jamming, you try to make the jammer use more energy than he or she would like to use, and that's how you defeat the jammer. Here, you try to make the attacker use more resources than desired by putting sensors so that the attack can't happen. So it's a different kind of, it's more of an algebraic kind of a study than statistical, actually. So I hope we don't ever have the kind of data you're asking for, because that would mean there'd be a lot of successful attacks. So.
In the cyber world, we talk about Byzantine failures, where a component can fail in an arbitrary way, so that it can give you one answer and give Dean Curtis a different answer, and maybe state dependent. I was wondering, does your consensus algorithm reflect this at all? Because people have worked on these problems for years. And I was wondering if your consensus and convergence algorithms deal with such kind of failures.
That's a very good question. So there is some recent work where there's an additional piece of detecting faulty sensors. It's not exactly a Byzantine attack, but it's related to that. So you try to first decide which sensors are reporting properly and then apply consensus and try to wall those off from the consensus. So there is some work like that. It really actually wasn't in the context of Byzantine attack. It was really more in the context of sensors are going to fail. But I think that would be something that might apply in that case. Yeah, good question. So.
Hi, you talked about the trade-off between utility and privacy quantified as information leakage versus energy wasted. I wondered if you could elaborate upon what you mean by wasted energy.
Right. So the load, ideally the load would, if it needs a certain amount of energy, would just draw it from the grid, and it would only use the energy it needs. Here you've got stored energy, you've got two other sources of energy, stored energy and energy being generated by the renewables, right? So there are three sources of energy, and you're trying to minimize the information leakage between the load and one of those sources of energy by using the other two in a certain way. And it might be at times you want to, in order to confuse the load, you might draw energy when the load is not from the main grid, when the load is actually not using energy, right? So you might try to flatline what's being drawn off the main grid. So that to do that, you would be wasting energy, basically, when you do that. So you'd have to just exit it into a dummy load
so
or something like that.
Wasted energy as peakiness in the usage profile as opposed to a flat usage profile?
No, it's drawing more energy than
overall energy than
is actually consumed by the load. Drawing more energy is consumed by the load. So in order to confuse is not the right word, in order to minimize the information leakage out of the meter. Yeah. So.
Any other questions? Okay. I have a question. Where do you think, how would you assess where we stand from the transition to the traditional grid, to the smart grid, in industry, for example?
I there may be others here who have a better sense of that, but I feel like we're still a long way. Because, the electricity grid is a very old infrastructure. It goes back at least 100 years. It's evolved the way it has for many, many years, mainly through tight regulation. And so we have a very centralized system still. And, the lights are on. I mean, that's sort of the pushback on smart grid is, well, the lights are on. Why are you complaining, right? So, and it's true, the lights are on. And it's because it's a very stable, conservative system. But the problem is it uses a lot more energy than it needs to keep the lights on. And that's, because of the heavy regulation, the importance of maintaining, keeping the lights on, I think innovation is slow to be introduced because it always is a risk that you'll start having some problems that you didn't foresee. So, you know, I can contrast it with, you know, cell phones, which is my where I've done most of my work. You know, that's a technology that goes back maybe to the mid-1980s, the first cell phones, so about 30 years, right? Unlike the power grid, which goes back 100 years. And the cellular system is now, those of us who are doing research in that area are working on the fifth generation of technology. So we're you have 4G now in your pocket or pocketbook, and you're going to have 5G in a few years. So five generations in 30 years, right? And this is equally ubiquitous technology. It's 5 billion users and so forth worldwide. But you have outage, you drop calls. You know, I mean, it's not as reliable as the power grid, right? It's more sophisticated, and you have smartphones and all that stuff. But in the end, you have to reboot your phone sometime and so forth. So it's a more conservative technology for very good reasons. And I think for that reason, the new technologies is going to be much slower to be introduced than in, say, like, you know, telecommunications. So not tomorrow. Things are already happening. I mean, it's not like nothing is happening. Like I said, PG&E has smart meters already. In Europe, some countries have almost 100% penetration of smart meters. Britain is, I think, by 2020 is saying that. In China, I think there's 500 million electric meters, and 400 million of them are smart meters. So it's happening. It's happening now. It's just a lot of the potential of that is going to take many, many years to be realized. So it's a good question. Okay, thank you.
So before we thank our speaker again, I want to make a few comments. One, we have a reception immediately following this and time to meet and greet with Dr. Poor or ask any other additional questions and for conversation. And also I wanted to present Dr. Poor with a gift. We send out a national mailing of our distinguished speaker every year, and we frame that for you as a memory.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all for coming, and thanks for your questions, too.